Very good morning, students. Welcome to biology classes. Today we are going to see 11th science biology, and we are going to see the fifth chapter, that is the morphology of flowering plants. We have already covered so many topics of this chapter, and yet we are going to cover the next other topics of this chapter, and we are about to complete this chapter in few days. So we have already seen about the positions of ovary, right? We have already seen the basics of this chapter, and we have already seen the parts of the flower too, that is the calyx, corolla, androecium and gynoecium. We have seen about the aestivation as well as the placentation part, right? So now today we are going to see the next part of this chapter, and that is the fruit, seed and other topics of this chapter. So now I'm going to show you the PPT on based of which we are going to start with today's lecture, right? So here I'm showing you.
I would like to give you a brief introduction of the story.
Okay, you can see that we have started with the next topic, and that is the fruit, right? So the fruit, in the fruit, parthenocarpic fruit is written, right? So the parthenocarpic fruit means the formation of fruits without fertilization of the ovary. So the fruits which are formed upon without the fertilization. So the fertilization process means the fusion of the male and female gametes. So the male and female gametes are not fused with each other, but still the fruit is formed, and that type of fruit is known as parthenocarpic fruit. So the fruit which are formed without carrying out the fertilization of ovary, those all types of fruits are known as parthenocarpic fruit. This is one of the important definition which is regularly asked in the exam. Next example of it is seedless grapes, right? The grapes which are present, which does not have seeds in between, right? Those all types of fruits are coming under the parthenocarpic fruit. So the one which is not containing the seeds, those are said to be the parthenocarpic fruit. Next, seedless orange is also one of the example of the parthenocarpic fruit. Now to Yash. Next is two parts of a fruit are pericarp and seeds, right? So here two parts of a fruit are pericarp and seeds, right? So pericarp and seeds, see here you can see that there is presence. You can see this figure, that this figure shows that the outermost layer here, you can see the outermost layer, which is said to be the epicarp. The middle portion which you eat is the mesocarp. The lining of where the seed is present, that is known as endocarp, and in the middle what is present, the seed. Same way in coconut also, you can see is the outer which is present, that is known as the mesocarp, right? It does not have epicarp. So the in coconut, the outer is mesocarp, in the between, that is the here this layer, the line which is the circular line which is observed, right, where I'm pointing the cursor, that is the endocarp, and in the middle the white portion which is there, that is the seed. So here you can see that this pericarp, it is having the function what, to carry out the protection of the plants, right? You can also see here that this also says that this parthenocarpic fruit, they are formed without the fertilization. Now the fruit wall is said to be the pericarp, and the pericarp may be dry or fleshy, right? So the pericarp in nature, what is the nature of pericarp? So it is dry as well as fleshy, right? So either it can be a dry one. So you can see here this particular, it is fleshy, right? But few of the fruits are having what, the dry type of layer. Next, when pericarp is thick and fleshy, it is differentiated into the outer epicarp and the middle mesocarp. So when the particular pericarp is thick and comparatively fleshy, right, at that moment it is divided or differentiated into two layers, and that is the outer one, which is said to be the epicarp, and the middle one, which is said to be the mesocarp, right? And the inner one is already said as the endocarp. Next is, in mango and coconut, the fruit is known as drupe, right? So in mango and coconut, the fruit which is formed in the middle portion, which you eat it, that is known as drupe. Now, these are the fruits which are said to be the parthenocarpic fruits. So they develop from monocarpellar superior ovaries and are one seeded, right? This, you can see there is presence of only one seed in the between. That means they are monocarpellar superior ovaries, right? So from where they are growing or where they are developing from monocarpellary. Monocarpellary means only single carpel is present. So when the single carpel is present, what happens? Superior ovaries, right? Superior ovaries means the particular ovary is present at the top of the thalamus. So it is not inferiorly present, but the particular ovary is superiorly present. So this type of, as it is containing one seed, they are developed from monocarpellary superior ovaries. In mango, the pericarp is well differentiated into an outer thin epicarp. So you have seen mango, right? So whatever you eat, that is also a epicarp, that is also what, a pericarp only, but the outer shell which is present, or the outer layer which is present on the top of the mango, that is what, the epicarp. And whatever you eat, that is the mesocarp. Then in coconut, which is also a drupe, the mesocarp is fibrous. You can see here the particular mesocarp, the outer covering of the coconut is a kind of fibrous like structures, right? So that is nothing but the outer part, right? And that is the mesocarp, right? So here in the fruit, what you have seen is about the parthenocarpic fruit. You have seen about the different layers of the fruit wall as well, right? And you have seen the examples, two different examples of the fruit, that is in the mango and the coconut. Now we are going to see that what exactly occurs in the seed. Now, when you're talking about the seed, what happens here, you see here that when you're talking about seeds, so here when you can, so see here the seed. So what are seeds? So seeds are the fertilized ovules, right? Fertilized ovules means they are going for the fertilization process, right? And they are made up of seed coat and an embryo. So they are made up of two things. First is the seed coat. So there will be outer covering which is going to cover the seeds which are present inside it. And also it is going to cover what, the embryo. So the seeds are made, made up of seed coat. So there will be a coat which is present around the seed as well as on the embryo. The embryo with radicle and plumule with one cotyledon or two cotyledon, right? So here you can see is the embryo can be present with two things, that is radicle and the plumule. So you can see here where I'm showing the cursor. So this is the cotyledon. You can see here, these are the cotyledons, the yellow portions which are present, right? As two cotyledons are present, so it is known as dicot seed or dicotyledon. If there is presence of one single seed, then it is known as monocotyledon, right? So here what happens, the particular seed, it shows as the, it is seen as the but this yellow colored seed is said to be the dicotyledon, right? Because it is containing two cotyledons. Now you can see here there is a presence of radicle as well as the presence of plumule. These two of them are present over here, and the embryo with these two of them, that is a plumule and the radicle, with one, either it can be present with the one cotyledon or either it can be present with the two cotyledons, right? Now we are going to see the structure of the dicot seed. In the structure of the dicot seed, there is presence of the seed cone, testa and tegmen, right? So these are the layers. You can see here also that what it is. So there are seed coat, testa, and tegment, right? These are the layers of the dicot seed. So this this dicot seeds contain what? This dicot seed contains what? The particular the dicot seed particularly contains this what? The layers, that is seed coat, testa, and tegment, right? Next is, you can see here also, the hilum is a scar. See, you can see the seed coat has two layers. The outer is known as testa and the inner is said to be the tegment. So here whatever I have written is that the particular structure of the dicot seed, normally the seed contains what? The seed coat, and this seed coat is containing two layers. That is, first is testa and the second one is tegment. The outer is said to be the testa and the inner one is said to be the tegment. Next is hilum. Hilum is a small pore where it is a place where it is attached to fruit. So the place at which the particular fruit is attached, right? The seed is attached to the fruit. So that region is known as the hilum. Next is micropyle, from which the water is entering inside the seed, or we can say inside the fruit till the seed. So even the seeds needs water for its development. So what happens? The seed is getting the water from the micropylar region, right? So next is what you can see is the endosperm, right? So this endosperm is present. Endosperm means it is the leftover, the seeds which is getting the nourishment, right? So from, if the particular there is presence of mature seeds as well as non-mature seeds also sometimes, right? So here three things are present in the seed. The first is endosperm, second is cotyledon, third is embryonal axis. This endosperm I'm going to further explain in the next topic, that there is in detail it is given about the endosperm. So endosperm, cotyledons, and embryonal axis are present. This embryonal axis is containing two parts. First is plumule and second is radicle. So this is said to be the embryonal axis. This is the plumule and this is the radicle. Then cotyledons are these two cotyledons, and endosperms are present inside it. Next, mature seeds in dicot do not have endosperm, called non-endospermic seeds. Now you can see the particular mature seeds in dicotyledons do not have endosperm. So the endosperm is not present in the mature seeds in dicot, right? So why it is not containing endosperm? See, when it is fully adapted, or if it is fully used, then there will be no presence of the endosperm inside the seed, right? See, you can see in the, when we are going to study the dicot and the monocot seed. So here what it is says is that the mature seeds in dicot do not have the endosperm. So the dicot seeds, the mature seeds of dicot, they do not contain the endosperm, and for this reason they are said to be endospermic, non-endospermic seeds. And stored food is utilized by the embryo. So whatever embryo is present inside the ovary, that is in the ovule, this particular embryo is going to utilize the stored food. And if it is utilizing the stored food, what happens? If all the things, or if all the food is utilized, right, then there will be no presence of endosperm. But if some what leftover is there, then it is going to form a fruit like or small seed like structure, which is known as endosperm. So you can see the next one, that is the structure of monocotyledonous seed. In monocot seed, mostly endosperm except orchids, right? So all the seeds are, almost most of the seeds are said and do possess endosperm, but the orchids are the one which do not contain what? The endosperm. Endosperm is bulky and it stores food. So what the function of endosperm is, that it is bulky, that means it is containing the food nutrients or the food particles, as well as it is having the ability to store the food. There is also present of a aleuron layer. See, you can see here the lining layer which is present over here, right? So this layer is what the particular aleuron layer, and the function of the aleuron layer is to produce enzymes to hydrolyze proteins for embryo. They produce the enzymes to hydrolyze. Hydrolyze means, lyse means to break down. So hydro means water, lyse means water. So hydrolyze proteins means those proteins which is going for the breakdown of the water molecules, right? So this aleuron layer, they produce such enzymes which break down the water proteins, or we can say the proteins which are made up of water, and it is going to be helpful to the embryo. Next is cotyledon is the scutellum. You see, this is one this is monocotyled. That means there is presence of only one cotyledon, and that is this cotyledon, right? So this cotyledon is containing what? The this cotyledon is nothing but it is said to be the scutellum, right? Next, there is protective coats which are present, right? The coleoptiles and the coleorhiza, right? Here it is plumule and here it is radicle, right? So there is presence of protective coats, right? The first coat is the radicle, which is you can see here, and the second is the plumule, which you can see here, right? So that is, this is coleoptile and the coleorhiza. So there is presence of CU. This is continuous, which is present. So this is the monocot seed in which there is a protective covering of this. Here the covering, the plumule, wherever the plumule region is present, at that portion it is known as coleoptile, and whenever the radicle is present, that region of layer is known as coleorhiza, right? So this is about the structure of the monocot seed. Next is the semi. Here we complete about the fruit, that is here. We have seen the structure of the monocot as well as the dicot seeds. You can even see here also, we have completed with this, that is the structure of the dicot seed. This is the structure of the dicot seed, and then the structure of the monocot seed. We have seen about this figure also, that there is presence of the aleuron layer. Then we have seen that about the radicle. At radicle, coleorhiza is present. At plumule, coleoptile is present. The next and the last topic of this chapter, that is a semi-technical description of a typical flowering plant. So there will be the presence of the family, which shows about the presence, or there is presence of several floral symbols or floral formula which are depicted by several symbols, through which you can easily understand that to which family does the flower contains, right? So you can see here, this is the here also, in this also you can see there is presence of, okay, so first is BR. If BR is written, then that flower is said to be the bracteate flower. That means the bract is present. If capital K is present, it depicts the calyx. If G is present, then it is known as inferior ovary, right? So here, if simply G is present, then it is known as inferior ovary. If K is present, then it is known as calyx. If capital C is there, then it is known as corolla. If P, capital P is there, then it is known as perianth. If capital A is there, then it is known as androecium. If G is present, right, then it is known as gynoecium. If there is presence of C, here you can see that if the particular G is present for the gynoecium, if G and an underline is present at the G, that is known as superior ovary. If G is present and on the top, if a line is present, that is known as inferior ovary. And the last is, if you want to say that the particular male, so for the male, this particular, you can see where I'm pointing the cursor, right? So this particular, the circle and the arrow on the top, that is, that this symbol is used for the male, and a circle at the down plus sign, it depicts the female, right? Next, this particular, that is the circle and both the arrows are present, that is for the bisexual plants, right? That means it is showing the bisexual condition, that is the male and the female both are present in a single plant. Next is a plus sign in the circle. It says about the actinomorphic, right? That is the radial symmetry. And the second is the percentage sign, which is depicting the zygomorphic flower. That means the bilateral symmetry. So for the radial symmetry, a circle with plus sign in the between is shown. And for the zygomorphic, that is the bilateral symmetry, the percentage sign is shown, right? So this is about all the different types of symbols which are used to form the floral formula. Next, you can see we are going to see different important families. So the first family is the Fabaceae, right? So this Fabaceae, there are a few vegetative characters of this family. This family was earlier called as Papilionidae and a subfamily of family of Leguminaceae. It is distributed all over the world. So here, this Fabaceae, it was previously known as Papilionidaceae, and here there is a presence of a subfamily of this family, that is Fabaceae, is Leguminaceae. So leguminous plants are coming under the Fabaceae family. The vegetative characters are, they are coming under the trees, shrubs, herbs, roots with root nodules. So here the trees are present, shrubs are present, herbs are there. So herb, shrub and tree, small type of plants are there, then medium sized plants are also there, and the tall trees are also coming under this. But they do possess the root with the root nodules. That is the main term, or that is the main example of the leguminous plants, right? The stem will be erect or climber, right? So either the stem can be erect. So if it is a tree or a shrub, then it will be erect. If it is herb, then it may be a climber. That is the tendril type of structures. The leaves are alternate. That means there is presence of the alternate position of the leaves. It is pinnately compound or simple. The leaves of some of the plants which are coming under the Fabaceae family, it is simple, and or either it can be presence, that is the, they are said to be the pinnately compound leaves. That is whatever you seen in the name leaf, right? Next is, there is presence of the leaf base, right? So there will be presence of leaf base through which the particular leaf is attached to the stem. There is presence of pulvinate also, that is through which the leaf and the stem, they both are connected with each other. Next is the stipulate, that is again the stipule, small bud like structures are present through which it can develop either a flower or a new leaf. Next, venation is reticulate. That means the reticulate type of venation is observed in this type of family, right? Now, next topic we are going to see is the floral characters, right? So here you can say is the next